Getting started with Java Cloud Service involves these main tasks. First, creating a service instance in Oracle Database Cloud Service. Java Cloud Service must be associated with a relational database in order to host the Oracle Fusion Middleware schemas. Next, creating a service instance in Java Cloud Service. Then, locating tools to further customize and manage your instance. And finally, deploying a Java application to your instance. First, I'll create a service instance in Oracle Database Cloud Service. After logging into Oracle Cloud, open the Database Console. As with all Oracle Cloud Services, when I create a Database Cloud Service instance, I can choose from several different billing options and software releases. I'll pay particular attention to the database name and password. I'll need to know these values again when I create my Java Cloud Service instance. In order to administer the VMs that make up my service instances, I need to configure SSH keys. To save me time, I'll let Oracle Cloud generate matching public and private key files, which I could then download to my local machine. If I need to remotely log into a database VM, I'll supply the private key file. Oracle Cloud automatically backs up data from my database and Java service instances, and older backups are moved to Oracle Storage Cloud. I need to provide the name of a Storage Cloud container along with the credentials to access it. To save time, I'll let Oracle Cloud create the container for me if it doesn't already exist. After my new database instance is provisioned and running, I can move on to the next task. Now I'm ready to create a service instance in the Java Cloud Service. Just like with the database service, when creating a Java Cloud Service instance, I can pick my billing option as well as the product version. I choose a compute shape that meets the CPU and memory requirements of my application. I provide the same public key file I downloaded earlier so that I'll be able to remotely log in to my WebLogic VMs by using the matching private key. Next, I need to set the initial size of the WebLogic cluster. I enter the admin credentials for the new WebLogic domain. Then I enable remote access to the WebLogic admin consoles. I also select the database cloud service instance that I created earlier and supply the credentials to connect to this database. Because I configured my WebLogic cluster size to a value greater than 1, Java Cloud Service can automatically provision a load balancer to intercept and distribute incoming client traffic across the servers in my cluster. Once again, I have the option to provide my storage container and credentials. Older backups of my Java service instance will be stored at this location. Now my new Java service is being provisioned, and I can periodically check its status. After my new Java Cloud Service instance is up and running, I can customize its configuration to meet my application requirements by using several different administration tools. For example, I might need to search WebLogic log files, tune a JDBC data source, or create a JMS server. I can accomplish these tasks from the standard WebLogic server console. The available functionality is the same as your on-premises WebLogic environments. Alternatively, I can use the Fusion Middleware Control Console to also configure, monitor, and manage my WebLogic domain. There may also be times that I need to monitor, tune, or troubleshoot the load balancer in this service instance. In Java Cloud Service, the load balancer is implemented with Oracle Traffic Director, and I can access the Traffic Director console to perform these types of tasks. Finally, I'm ready to deploy my Java applications to my new Java Cloud Service instance. I have all the same deployment options as I have in my on-premise WebLogic environments. I could use the Fusion Middleware Control Console or the WebLogic scripting tool, for example, but in this case, I'll use the standard WebLogic Server Console to install my new application. In this typical scenario, I browse to the deployment archive file and then target the application to my entire cluster. After uploading and installing my Java application, I can start it. Because I enabled a load balancer, my clients will access the application through the load balancer's public IP address. Thanks for watching this video about getting started with Oracle Java Cloud Service. A companion tutorial is also available that documents all the steps I just presented. Welcome to the cloud.